Good evening, everyone. I'm Richard Armstrong. I'm director of the Solomon R. Guggenheim Foundation and Museum, and we're very happy that you're here this evening for the Elaine Turner Cooper Education Fund Conversations with Contemporary Artists featuring Reem Fadda, our associate curator of Middle Eastern art with the Guggenheim Abu Dhabi Project, and congratulations, recently appointed curator for the National Pavilion of the United Arab Emirates at the 55th Venice Biennale, and our honored guest, Mohammed Kazem, featured artist for the National Pavilion of the UAE at the Venice Biennale. Before handing the microphone over to them, I'd like to make a few acknowledgments, particularly to Adam and Alan and Stephen Mnuchin for generously endowing this series in memory of their mother, Elaine Turner Cooper, who was a devoted supporter of the Guggenheim and of contemporary art. We look forward to hosting Zarina Hashmi this Friday and the 2012 Hugo Boss Prize winner Dan Vo on March 19 in the same series. I'd also like to thank Dr. Lamiz Hamdan, Commissioner of the National Pavilion for the United Arab Emirates at the 55th International Art Exhibition in Venice, and her staff for their support of tonight's program in all of its aspects. Let me say a few words about Reem. In addition to her new role as curator for the exhibition in Venice between 2005 and 2007, Reem was director of the Palestinian Association for Contemporary Art and worked as academic director to the International Academy of Art Palestine, which she helped found in 2006. She co-curated and has been involved in many projects, such as Liminal Spaces, a four-year-long artistic and political project consisting of conferences, tours, art residencies, and exhibitions in Palestine, Israel, and Germany. Tarjama, Translation, and Art East program showcasing 30 artists from the Middle East and Central Asia at the Queen's Museum of Art and the Herbert E. Johnson Museum at Cornell. And Reem, as you know, was granted a Fulbright scholarship to pursue her PhD at the Art History and Visual Arts Department of Cornell, where she's currently a candidate. She will provide more details about the sequence for tonight's program, but I look forward at the end of the discussion here to inviting you upstairs to the rotunda. Unfortunately, the museum galleries are not open this evening, but they will be every other day nearly, and we invite you back to see what we think are exceptional programs at the Guggenheim, particularly this one. Reem.
Thank you, Richard, for that wonderful introduction. It is my pleasure to be here tonight. And before I begin, I have a few thanks of my own and some additional housekeeping notes. I'd like to acknowledge the contributions of the public programs and theater department, without whom this program would not have happened. Some other thank yous from, I also have to thank Dr. Lamiz Hamdan and all the staff, Claudia Cellini, Rosemary Stubbs, from the UAE Pavilion for doing a fantastic job so far. It's been great. And also my team from the Guggenheim Abu Dhabi, especially with the leadership of Valerie Hillings and Nancy Spector, and my colleague Sasha Kalter-Wasserman. I'm going to begin tonight's program with about a 40-minute presentation, and the title of it is going to be The Contemporary History of the UAE Art Scene, in which I will discuss basically the art practice that has happened in the UAE from the mid-1970s with the formation of the state, and then give a kind of introspective look at the landscape of the UAE's vanguard artists and institutional framework, and ground it to the practice of Mohammed Kazem as a leading artist from that spectrum. After the lecture, Mohammed will join me to discuss his artistic practice, and I will introduce him then. After our conversation, we will open up for your questions. We ask that you please use the standing microphones you see over there in front of the stage to ask your question. In that tonight's program is going to be live streamed, I encourage our online audience watching the live broadcast to use the hashtag KazemUAE to join the conversation and pose questions on Twitter, which I plan to take. In closing, please be aware that photography is not permitted during the program. Now I'm going to start my presentation. for to start really thinking about how I'm situating the artist from the UAE that I've worked with and all the research that I've been trying to do about the UAE art scene. The first question that comes to my mind is, where is that history? How is it located, and how do we approach that history? There's always this question of comparison with other cities. For example, if you want to compare the scene in New York to the scene in the UAE, in any city in the UAE, you find that there's a misbalance. And I think it's because the tools that we look at in terms of gauging the development of this art practice is the kind of misbalance. Our understandings of modernity and the shaping of modernity is what really causes that kind of misbalance. To give an example, you see, if you compare in the 70s between New York and Dubai, you'll see a desert and you'll see a booming city. And you assume, because our logic is very much entrenched in thinking about material development, that that's the way to go in terms of the comparison. There's no material growth, and hence it's a backward country, or there's not enough development. And I find that logic has applied. We constantly find ourselves hindered and trying to prove that that's not, that there was material development from any different reasoning. And then I think the approach should be way different. It's about a different kind of development. There's other circumstances, as everybody knows, in terms of post-colonial studies, et cetera, that have constantly been rammed in, that we need to approach this from looking at where the scene is about introspection, looking at it from where the development of arts and artists and cultural practitioners were questioning these core ideas. What does it mean for material growth to happen? What does it mean for a boom to happen in a city? How do we respond to it as societies? That is where development, that is where modernity really shows its face. And I think that's a very important kind of point to sort of underscore as we're going forward in my discussion. And of course, if I want to give an example about like material boom, in 1932, the UAE encouraged oil digging. It exported it in 62. So, I mean, we can start to do that, but I don't think that's the way we want to go about. We really want to focus on the synthesis of those artists that have been present and those cultural thinkers that have sort of taken in the logic of their communities, what has happened around them, and projected it through their works. And really to talk about how that development happened, we need to understand that part of the hindrance of the material development is, of course, there's colonialism. There's the British mandate that has had its grips on the society for quite a long time and didn't allow for material growth that was not administered by them. So talking about the independence of the UAE, you see this rush and boom that happened in the scene that tells you that they were sort of waiting to gush all those developments in the arts and culture and the many facets of their societies. And they did it with full force, and that's what we see today really out of that development. So as soon as the UAE gained independence in 1971, we started to see the first kind of recorded achievements of art exhibitions of young artists in Dubai in the General Library in 1972. That was one of the first recorded exhibitions. You really sense that the propelling of that nation forward through the endorsement of arts and culture, through building institutions, the exhibitions, the scholarships, the awards. It was on multiple fronts. So, for example, they even started to encourage the development of the arts in the curriculums in the schools, but they knew that they didn't have the infrastructure to support it, so they were sending a lot of the artists to scholarships everywhere else, and there were several institutions and academies of arts in the region, in particular in Baghdad and Egypt. So many artists were going there, and that was a real center for the arts and culture at that time. But also, a lot of the UAE artists were going on full scholarships to Britain and the USA as well. We saw the engagement of artists in the UAE with the entire region. And I think that's something that we really need to highlight. This, what does this history look like? This history is a, we have to consider that this idea of nation state, of course, is a colonial idea imposed on that entire region. So there's a connectivity that has happened. Of the bursting of this new nation called the UAE in 72 is something new, but there was always a communication happening from early on in this, of course, for centuries across the region. And that's the continuity that we really need to place that hub. So if we think about other centers versus the centers today, it's the way to think forward for that entire region. So the other centers would have been Egypt, in the arts particularly, Cairo was a booming center for the arts from the early century. So what happened is, with a decline in other centers, you saw, and the boom, particularly because of oil, you saw that there was rising cities, as we see today, in Dubai and Abu Dhabi, and they, from the 70s, the Gulf played a major role in receiving artists from Palestine, from Lebanon, from key areas that had been suffering wars. The 70s saw that the Gulf became, I always put that comparison between New York post-war and what was the Gulf for the Arab artists of the region from the 70s onwards. So you have, think about these centers as new places to be havens for the artists and for the cultural producers, and allow them through the wealth of the country to really support them and support their creative endeavors. And we saw several exhibitions happening. You saw the artists immediately showcasing from the UAE, showcasing in exhibitions elsewhere. So in Algeria in 1973, they were participating in the annual, in the Arab Arts Festivals that happened there. In Baghdad in 1977, in Rabat in 1979, in 1981, in Damascus, and in Riyadh in 1983. And soon after, of course, we know that there was the Emirates Art Society that was founded in 1980 through the initiative of artists, artists like Hassan Sharif. And that's, and we'll talk about Hassan Sharif in a moment. So these artists really founded the society in order to start to cultivate the language of the institution within the UAE itself. And then also we saw the forming of the Sharjah Biennial, which is a very important event that happened as early as 93 and continues to this day with a very, with a stellar kind of art programming that has always been about internationalism. And it's very important how much they are outreaching from the region and developing those networks in the region and cultivating the production of works by artists from the region, but also internationally. They're quite a prominent player. Now, as I said, there was plenty of artists that from the region that also started to be hosted in the Gulf, in Dubai, in Abu Dhabi, in Sharjah. Many artists such as Dia al-Azawi, Fatih al-Mudarris, Shakir Hassan al-Said, and they had their influential thinking really affecting the discourse in the UAE. And we saw the burgeoning of sort of what is today acknowledged as three generations of artists from the UAE. The early generation, the main kind of the first generation of artists were Ibrahim Mustafa, Muhammad Youssef, Hassan Sharif, Hamad al-Swedi, Abdel Qadir al-Rayis, Abdel Rahim Salem, Abed Srour, Abdel Rahman Znayil, Muhammad Mendi, Hussein Sharif, and to name the others. Also, the second generation you have, of which Mohammed Kazem is a really key player, there's also Abdullah Saadi, Tariq al-Ghussein, Muhammad Ahmed Ibrahim, Ibtisam Abdel Aziz, Leila Jum'a, Huda Saeed, Muna Abdel Qadir. And really, I want to really focus on the early first two generations as much as possible within the PowerPoint and the conversation. And I want to focus on the works of what I see was the real discourse about contemporary art and its relationship to the society. Why did I premise my talk on this idea of modernity? Because initially there was a real discussion about the arts that was about a modern discourse in painting. You had key players like Shakir Hassan Al-Said, who's an Iraqi painter, an important artist, a pioneer, that discussed the important usage of the philosophy of using calligraphy, the philosophy of using the letter. And that was a very important discussion throughout the 60s and 70s. But then here comes an artist from the UAE, and I'm going to start my PowerPoint here, who is Hassan Sharif. Hassan Sharif, who I feel is a real anchor if you want to come to understand the contemporary practice that starts to shape the ideas in the UAE from the late 70s onwards. He's in discussion, he's in dialogue with what these artists are doing. And he's looking at this practice and seeing that it's not enough. This material growth that is happening in the UAE, can it be told through the painting? How much does Sufism and philosophy of the calligraphic and the abstract nature talk about this material growth? Where is the society of the person? Where is the social? Where is the person? Where is the body? Where are the logics that are about existentialism, about the phenomenology of the body in the placement of society? He's someone who received a scholarship, went to the Bayam School of Art, learned a lot about conceptual projects, really exposed to the Fluxus movement and constructivism in Britain, and comes with all these theories, but is taking them in a discourse to tackle head-on ideas about development, modernity, growth, but also looking at this idea about where I position my own culture, and thinking about tradition even in a sort of buttressing way. Where does tradition start to become something that would hold me back? And he reflects it through art that is very new in its modalities, in its experimentation, at least to the region. But it's also quite progressive. So here we see a performance of a work that he did in 79, as early as 79, which is fingerprints. Just recording his fingerprints on a large sheet of paper, which unfortunately does not exist now, but you see the documentation is what remains of this work. And here, this idea of a quotidian act is a way to say that I imprint my existence. I am there to be a witness to the development of the society. The quotidian act, the practice of jumping number one, and this was part of a series that he's done of several works in Hatta, Dubai, in his residence, in the backyard of his residence, and really this moment of this leap. What does this deconstruction of he calls these performances, but they're really a deconstruction of these aspects of life that are very expected, but they're also metaphorically, symbolically important to understand them in different ways. And here, this is one of kind of my favorite pieces, walking. And he walks in the deserts of Dubai. And I think it's so interesting to see Sufism and philosophy in a different kind of venture. So you're not looking at it no longer on the panel of a painting, but you're seeing it prescribed in that desert landscape. And there are so many artists, of course, that have from the 60s and 70s that have dealt with the desert, but here he is a pioneer doing that quite well, and you see him kind of disappearing in the horizon of that desert, but also commemorating the place and the symbolism of that place. Again, sound of the act, so drinking. A lot of these, he's really concerned about how do I exist in the world. Another kind of very important thing for Hassan Sharif, when you speak to him and you have these conversations, he tells you vehemently that he's really against dogmatic thinking. He hates anything that will put you in a box. He wants to deconstruct everything. Nothing is accepted. Not drinking, not walking, nothing is accepted. Everything needs to be explored. Everything needs to be looked at. All of these done deals, the way we act in society, have to be taken and challenged. So he starts with the very act of drinking to tell you that everything else needs to be explored. And I think that's a very important kind of premise to understand the work. again. Now he starts to look at another series of his works that he calls objects. He doesn't work with sculpture because he works with found materials. So here, objects are all these found materials in his house that he takes and he records. And why is he recording it? He's obviously, there is a level of this idea of consumerism that is starting to envelop the environment, and he's really concerned about that. And he talks about it, and he talks about how we are sort of cluttered with things, but there's also a relationship to things. There's also a human relationship to things. So they kind of hold our existence within them in that materiality. And that relationship to the material is very important in our understanding of Hassan's work, and later you'll see it quite strongly as well in Muhammad's. The more developed objects, so they start to form into these cluttered objects. He starts to take multiple elements and place them one on top of the other. I don't have many examples, but I'm sure that you'll start to recognize the signature style, buckets placed and churned together with these threads, weaved together to create these mounds and heaps that look like rubbish. Once he was installing the Sharjah Biennale, and the workers thought that they were rubbish, and they actually took them away and wanted to throw them. So this is just the relationship, but it's like, it's him responding to everything in his surrounding. Everything becomes precious, and that's an important note. Now, this is the work that I think is I think it's quite pioneering for Hassan Sharif, and it's his semi-system. So we dealt through the experiments, the performances, the objects, but the last of his components are his semi-systems. And here I think it's very interesting how he thinks about, again, existence. The most important thing that he took from the ideas of the constructivists and the fluxus and all the conceptual kind of artists from Sol LeWitt to others, they did a lot of things that really took modernity and the grid and ideas of building society in the 1-2-3 form. The geometry is sacred. And he's, because he does not believe in dogma, because nothing for him is sacred in that way, he could break down anything. And he tells you that the logic is illogical. And anything is open to chance and error. And I think that's an important thing for us to recognize in his work. So his semi-systems are called semi-systems because systems are meant to be broken. And they are meant to encapsulate chance and error and misjudgment and going wrong. They have to take that all in. And he creates drawings based on that. He does things like he'll go through a dictionary, pick a word randomly, and then create, and then that word will correspond to a page in the dictionary, takes that random page number, does some weird calculations that he doesn't even remember that he did, and then he will go ahead and create these drawings, these abstract drawings, these color-coded structures in black and white based on randomness. And I think, and he does them in series too. So these are some of the ideas that are very important in Hassan Sharif's practice. And how does he connect to our friend, Mohammed Kazem, who's the topic of this discussion, who's the artist that I'm working with for the Venice Biennale, who I think is a leading contemporary artist for us and really carrying this legacy forward. Mohammed met Hassan Sharif when he was 14, so very early age, and he met him when he was going through, he left school to start to really be trained with Hassan Sharif on a nearly daily basis. This relationship continues to this day. They are very close, really very close, and they meet nearly every day or speak on a daily basis. There's quite a deep conversation and also a personal relationship that is held between these two artists. All the ideas that we see percolating in Hassan Sharif's work, Kazem really embodied them, takes them in a different way, but he also leaps forward in a variety of different directions. First, he started to really be trained. I don't have images, but I want to tell you that he, from the age of 14, he was trained in Impressionism and Post-Impressionism. He really is a great painter. He knows how to paint. So that is something that he masters. But I feel that that's a great thing, but there's still really important leading works that he's done and breakthroughs in his practice, which I prefer to focus on. And I think a different way of painting that I would like to show in his work, which we'll come to at a later stage. Another additional note that I want to talk about Mohammed's work, which is that he, there's two aspects that you, I think the audience need to know. He studied music and was oscillating between this idea, do I go into a musical career or do I stay within the visual arts? But he was really entrenched in this idea of music. He studied at the Royal Music School in between 1990 and 91. So another thing for you to know is that he finished his artistic studies, but then he moved into, he started working with the military. So, and he still is with the military. So these are, he needed a day job. The arts were, you know, important, and they were cultivated, and they were burgeoning, but they were still not seen as that kind of primary place to build a career in. So the military paid the bills. So it's really important to look at how, from that painting, he moves forward. He moves forwards towards experiments, like his teacher. So here we see a set of first experiments that he does with paper, with this idea of the material. And I think the most important thing to look at in Muhammad's particular practice, which I think is very different, is he is very introspective about his relationship with the material. And he, as opposed to Hassan Sharif, who is more conservative, really, I would say, in his usage of materials. So he did these performances in the early 80s, but he starts to use these objects and materiality in a different kind of code of producing. Mohammed goes in a different direction. He starts with paper, and he starts with creating these, looking at, now, where Hassan is deconstructing material and does these piles, Mohammed does these. He constructs a different vocabulary of panels, of painting. You can think about this keys, these two panels that hold just the ideas of hooks of keys that are on a painted acrylic panel in a way that you would understand a painting. But it's also, again, this idea of the quotidian act, of where we place ourselves. And he actually did research on the producers of keys in the UAE. So he went on a kind of social research to understand those practitioners and how these small practices were really cultivated in the UAE art scene. Here he is producing that work in as early as 95. And in this piece where he starts to document himself and his body, how does it relate to other aspects in the society? So Hassan did that, but here the relationship of the body of Muhammad to his surroundings starts to have a much more direct connotation. He uses his tongue to explore his surroundings. So the idea of the interior, the exterior, this idea of the subjective has to really become immersed within the environment that is around him. Legs, the way legs and arms here, as we see this in this this series, and it's a photographic series of 19 photographs in his multiple positions, and these are games they used to play as children. So again, this deconstructive act of acts of childhood, of positioning of the body, the relationship of these factors of the body. Another important work here is a wooden box, and here we find a wooden structure that corresponds to his height, and he places himself in a sort of a performative act in relation to the boxed bookshelf of each aspect, and then he documents it and leaves the wooden box installed with images of these different positions on that wooden box inlaid. So this is a work that he did also in 1996. Now, I'll come to this he starts to develop these works that are much more elongated as a series. And I think it's an important thing to look at his relationship, not just to the material, but now he's starting to go broader in terms of the social and looking at his environmental, the environment, nature, are very important elements for Mohammed Kazem. And to really understand that, we need to start to situate that practice on to see his larger projects. And time and space are also important elements. So for Mohammed, it wasn't enough to do a project that was just one-off. The building up of an act, he wanted to see what its relationship over time does. And here we can see the development of his ideas really showcasing. For example, in the series that we see here, photographs with flags, he does it from 97 to 2003, as far as I remember. So for example, here we find Mohammed situated, he's noticing obviously the development of his society, the boom, in Dubai specifically, in the early, in the 90s in particular. So the late 90s were really that time when we see these buildings starting to pile up. And he positions himself in front of that structure, in front of these structures. And he looks at that and he takes those snapshots, but he's not doing it, again, not one-off. This is a series over time. And that's how we need to see this practice, that documentation of how the aspect of this society is building up. So more images that are of a recent time here in 2003. These were actually used as the cover image for the Sharjah Biennial in 2005, as you can see here. This is right in front of the Sharjah Museum, installed in another artist's work. This is not Mohammed Kazem's work. And this is the Sharjah Museum right in front of it. And then he goes on to do another series, which is called Windows. And in Windows, he noticed the building of a hotel from the window, the landscape of a window in Sharjah. This is a project that he developed for Sharjah. And basically, he starts to document the process of that building coming up and the workers that are actually building that building, documenting the social aspects of what it means for these things, these sites to happen. And I think, and his placement in front of the window, in front of that building, you can see here it starts to grow from beyond the window. And I think in that development, there's a reminder again of this time, of the element of the material growth, the modernity of the placement of the artist, the person, the thinker, in relation to all of these elements. Here are some documentation of the workers, etc., which is also a commentary on the status of labor, the status of workers in the region, etc. So there's a lot of critical discourse that the UAE artists were some of the real kind of important people to start to instigate discussions of that nature. And I think it's very important to see that as a wholesome critical discussion within the UAE itself. And here, there's another series called Space, and this is again inspired by Windows, but he goes further ahead through his travels. And I think this is a very important thing, because here the artist is not, he recognizes that the realm, the place is not just the UAE, it's beyond that. So we can function as artists. There is a level of our practice that goes beyond borders. So here he documents images from windows in multiple places in the world. Sorry, I don't have detailed images, but you can see here the Tour Eiffel and several other, Giza, Egypt, Dubai, every place he was able to travel. More, we are coming into this idea of his paintings and where he really becomes the star figure in his the way he starts to interpret painting, which is I hope you can see the real kind of finesse gestures in these paper works, because it's very important. Mohammed is obsessed about making elements such as sound and light visible in a three-dimensional way. I mean, I found it throughout his practice. And it's so interesting to see that. His relationship to music, this relationship of the body, becomes entirely embodied. He wants it to be on a multiple fold. And there, you can really see it in the gestures that he does in these paintings. From mid-90s, from the early 90s, from 93, he starts to do these scratches on papers that, again, hold time, light, the visual element, and a sort of a documentation of the effort and the sound. And this embossed movement becomes very important to tell about the logic. And these series he's produced, and I think, I don't know the exact numbers, but there is probably 100 or even more floating of these works in multiple colors and renditions. And they, in this minimalist aspect, really want to capture the elements, want to capture everything. And it's very important for Mohammed, for example, that the embossed effect and the way it responds to light creates movement. So it holds multiple fronts. You have to think about it as this three-dimensional body relationship. Now we come to a very important series that I will end with, and to talk about it very briefly, because I notice that I'm running over time. Directions is a series that he does that really starts in the late 90s, and I'll let Mohammed talk about this experience further, but he uses the GPS to document where his location is, these signals. And, you know, on asking Mohammed why he does this, he tells you, I want to record where I am. I want to emanate my existence. And I think it's a very important statement that these numbers, these tools of multimedia, start to shape up his discourse. Here he does writes these GPS coordinates of a location in the UAE, in Dubai, and he throws these panels, these wooden panels, in the sea, and they float out in the sea. And this interpretation of the opening of borders, the land coming into the sea, the position of the body floating into the aspect. I think he even wants to walk on water. I feel that there is a level of him that wants to kind of conquer these elements. So these are some of the documentation images, but look at how it starts to transform into these multimedia installations using light, natural elements. So these are the GPS coordinates of a certain area, and you find leaves that are underneath these LED paneled embossed acrylic panels and with a projection on top of them. And here on a different format, he continues to do directions in multiple ways. He's obsessed with it. He's obsessed with this idea of, like, where I am. What do these symbols, these things that emit where I am, tell about my existence? And here they are in panel sequins. So it's an entirely different way of looking at painting and the hand gesture. So it's a different kind of format. And you can see him using the GPS, sort of bending down to put the position of... and here it's a proposal for the GPS to be on a riding elevator, moving up and down as well. He did this intervention. He does a lot of interventions also that are just documented, but they disappear within nature itself. So this idea of disappearance is something that he is very at ease with as well. So the documentation, the GPS coordinates, are held within the photograph, within that moment. And here with light, so he captures light in a three-dimensional format. The way the light, these curtains that have the numbers embossed on the windows, and these curtains reflect that in a way that how the light comes and goes, the work is really affected by it and tells that story on a multiple in multiple ways across time and is read in a different way across time. I know that I spoke a lot, so I think I will end here. And I would like to invite now Mohammed Kazem to join me on the stage. Mohammed Kazem, who's born in 1969 in Dubai, United Arab Emirates, studied fine arts at the Emirates Fine Arts Society and subsequently studied music at the Al Rayyal Music Institute of Dubai and painting at the Edinburgh College of Art. He was a painting instructor at the Dubai Art Atelier for 10 years, widely known through numerous solo and group exhibitions in the UAE and abroad. Kazem's participation includes the Havana Biennial, Singapore Biennial in 2006, Dhaka Biennial in Bangladesh in 2002, the Sharjah Biennial, 93 to 2007. Most recently, he exhibited at the University of the Arts Philadelphia in 2010 and at the Mori Art Museum in Tokyo 2012. His works have been collected by private collectors and institutions such as the Deutsche Bank and JP Morgan Chase Bank USA, as well as museums in Doha, Qatar, Sharjah UAE, and Sittard Holland. And Kazem, as we all know, will be the featured artist for the UAE Pavilion at the 55th International Art Exhibition, La Biennale di Venezia. Welcome.
Thank you, Reem. Thank you for attending here. So, I think, Reem, you have done everything. So you said everything. You didn't let me just...
No, you have a lot to say. I know that for a fact. We still encourage questions to come from online, but I'll start this conversation with a few questions myself that I think will also give a lot of ideas to the audience about your practice, but I'd like them to hear them from you. And I would like first to say, I gave a presentation about your work, but what do you think are the ideas, the main ideas from you as an artist? What connects your projects together? What are the themes that we have to look at?
Actually, in the fact, my work is related to global transformations that are occurring today in the social life and the political life, and also in the natural environment. So my work has two aspects, is objectivity and subjectivity. Sometimes I raise several issues, like a political issue and environmental issue. Beside of that, I do something which is objectivity. With using different kind of the multimedia, you can say, I use a video, photographs. Beside of that, also I use conventional tools if it's necessary to support and convey my work.
Yeah. I mean, it's very important that you're pointing out that your work is about political and social criticism and really thinking about all of these important representation. I also wanted to ask you, why the GPS? Why do you use the GPS? How did it start? This story, I think, is a very important story to be told, and I think the audience would enjoy knowing it.
As you know, in the past, and first when I started to use conventional tools, like a painting, with using all this media. In the mid of 90s, I used to go for fishing. I mean, three times a week. Mm-hmm. And once it happened that I fell from the boat.
You fell?
When I returned, and so... Because of the sound of the engine was too high, the crew and the people who were in the boat, they didn't hear me when I flew. So then I was swimming for half an hour to different direction, because when you go to the deep sea, you see the horizon is 360, and then they noticed I was not there. Then they came back, and I was raising my hand, shouting, so then they found me.
They found
me.
You.
They found me.
This is important.
So this is story actually, it had a big impact on my life. So then I said, so why I'm not going to use the GPS? Because we use the GPS actually for the cage. It's kind of the traditional cage we're using for the fishing. We threw them in the deep sea. Then after 3 days or 4 days, we used to go and take them back. Then we used to save the those location of those cages through the GPS. Mm-hmm. But then after in 1999, I started what call it feeds. So I used to photograph the people in the street and asking them, I want to shoot your feeds with the GPS.
Then so the GPS really
the
became...
The GPS became part of the... I give the GPS multiple meaning and various meaning so and different dimensions. I'm not using GPS and giving the same function. I can't maybe go through...
So you don't want to be lost? You want to...
No, I don't want to be lost again. So if you go through one of those works, which is Directions 2006.
Okay.
Triangle.
Yeah. What are that? We're whizzing through very quickly. Mm-hmm. Here we are.
Yeah. I mean, I had a show with a group of conceptualism artists from state, like Joseph Kodos, Daniel Breen, Lawrence Weiner, and Francis Molley. The theme of the exhibition was When Ideas Become Form. So this is the shape of triangle, but it is a process of making triangle. The shape of triangles is not there. It's not existing anymore there. So I give the triangle different shape. So it's like standing in 3 points in the Dubai city, and I was receiving the coordinates, and I saved them in the GPS. But then when I made the conclusion, how many one I received, how many zero I received, and how many five I received, all those figures and number, I put them together. But in the end, there's no triangles, but it is a triangle.
That's very important and very interesting. I did want to ask you about, and I think it's important for people to know about, your relationship with Hassan Sharif. Do you have any stories to tell us?
Do you have a time for that? 1 day or 1 week? Yeah, we have been working together over nearly 30 years, actually. When I was 14 years old, I left the school, as you said, and I joined Hassan Sharif in the Fine Arts Society. And Hassan, when he came, he felt there's a gap between the society and the art, especially the contemporary art. So he was encouraging young artists to attend his workshops. So he was teaching me the general painting. So he used to come really seriously daily, and sometimes he used to pick up me from the house to take me to the Fine Art Society. Both of us, we are living in Sharjah in Dubai, mm-hmm. but we are going to the Fine Art Society in Sharjah, which is the central association for the art there. And he was not only teaching art, he was publishing articles and essays about international artists, like conceptualism artists, American artists, and European artists in the main supplement culture in the Al-Khalij newspaper that time. And he's still writing about the artists, and he used to write about my work. And after 2 years, he organized himself my solo exhibition. And I remember even he developed all those photographs, and he was teaching me to how to archive, which is now I have archived. One reason, because of Hassan Sharif, I guess, since almost all those images and slides which I have me over 30 years because of him. So then between us, they were not only Hassan, they were also poets, which is they were so active and important. And mostly we used to meet there in the Fine Arts Society, semi-daily there. And they were very active because they were working as a journalist in the newspaper. So with regard of Hassan also, he was working in the Ministry of Education. So he was in charge of many activities, organizing show for the artists. They used to see, he used to encourage us to go outside of the UAE.
You became a scene together. There, I remember that there was the exhibition that happened, the five artists in the Emirates Fine Arts Society. You were coined the five artists. Five artist exhibitions, and it was you, Hassan Sharif, Abdullah Saadi, Hussein Sharif, and Mohammed Ibrahim, correct?
I was myself and Hassan Sharif, Hussein Sharif, Mohammed Ahmed, and Abdurrahim Salam. Abdullah Saadi was in Japan that
okay.
time. So the fifth, actually we don't have a manifesto to say that we are a group. The society, they give us a manifesto that they are a group of the five, or they are a group of
And that was because you're different in your approach for multimedia, and you were doing these works that were not accepted, let's put it this way, in terms of...
That's one reason. I mean, we felt we are very close to each other, but everyone has his own way of making art, and we used to talk about art. We used to live together also. I think, as I mentioned, we also continue this kind of the project and exhibition not only with Hassan. There's a Dutch artist whose name Joost Klevers. In 95, he's seen this show and he took it to the art center to Holland, to the Sittard Art Center in Holland. Then through our Sittard Art Center, we have been invited by Ludwig Form in Germany. So they made exhibition for five of us. They call it the five UAE.
Mohammed, when you transitioned from painting to experiments, to doing this experimental work, how was that transition? How did you, how were you able to move, and was it easy? What happened?
It was naturally the fact. It wasn't my intention to stop painting and go to experiment different work. Again, between I influenced by experimental music. So you can see, example, if you go to the work of the scratches, you can see. So I was trying to find a different way to add music in my work, which is, if you see, each scratches has a different sound and it has a different time also. So how to keep those scratches moved? Again, so now when you scratch, the shades come because of light. In order to keep this movement and has infinity movement, so I was showing this work affecting by the sunlight. So when the sun's moving, the shade is moving with it.
And
it is, again, it is sound. It is sound that it's there to visualize the sound and giving that infinity movement. So through the natural light, I think.
So it was easy for you not to be accepted by society doing all of these different works. People didn't know how to deal with them. How did you deal with it?
I think, yeah, this is we are facing because of the policy of education, the fact. I mean, we are continue making this kind of work and was not acceptable. And I think there's still gaps everywhere, even here, and even in Europe. But there was, the gap was quite wide because of the education, I think.
Yeah.
Because I think we have to change the policy of education, especially in the visual art, and especially in the contemporary art, because those people whom left to study art abroad in Egypt or in Syria, some of them, they came with a conventional the thought.
You were also not just an artist, but you teach. You taught for a long period of time. You were a curator in multiple things. Give us the examples of the works and why you really did all of that work.
I think this is issue which we learned from the first generation, because the first generation, when they came to the UAE, like Hassan and there's other people whom, again, emphasizing on the conventionals, they were making kind of the social work. They used to go and teach young people. In 99, Hassan, he told me that I want you to be in charge of this workshop and continue teaching. Then we found, after Sharjah Biennial, especially in 2003, the young artists, they don't want to repeat the name of the artist again in the Biennial every 2 years. I was participating in the Sharjah Biennial from 93 until 2007. So I was teaching the new generation art with Hassan also. He's coming, he used to come once or twice a week to give them the lecture. Then I was teaching them again basic from the beginning. To put this, is the life arranged for them, this is the life, and how to transfer the subject from the two dimension to three dimension, to teach them how to look to the things first. And they need all these elements and tools to learn first. Beside of that, I felt there was no any curator in the region, and especially in the GCC. So I was also organizing show for them, following all the process of their artwork. So after 2 years, two of the artists, they have been invited by the Sharjah Biennial for 2005, I think. They invited Ibtisam Abdulaziz and Noha Asad. Then in from the Sharjah Biennial, these two artists, they have been invited with myself to first Singapore Biennial, believe by Form Yunanjo. So again, this is the result of our workshop. And I have done all this work for nearly 10 years. Then I stopped. Now I'm focusing
on your art,
on my own work.
And last question before we take questions from the audience, as I'm sure people are eager to ask you questions. Describe your relationship to painting. I know I talked about it, but how important is it to your practice?
I think most of my work, actually, I'm influenced by painting a lot. You can see, especially, the way I'm using the light, the way I'm using the symmetry in my work, the way I'm the morphological way, which is I was which is it isn't conventional painting and sculpture also, but you can see it in my so my work has a very deep roots with the painting.
Okay. We would love to welcome questions by the audience, and please just remember to come to the front to ask any of your questions. And if there are any questions from our online audience, we also welcome that.
I'd like just to know more about this idea of working in the military. You worked maybe, I think you told me once, in the stockroom, and how this multiple layer of organizing things maybe influenced your work and how you go about your studio work in that kind of fashion of multiples, and this idea of working through the military, of organizing things in the room.
Maybe you
want to
talk about the work, yes, actually.
Can go to the wooden box.
Yeah, wooden boxes.
Actually, I joined the military when I was 16 years old, just to support myself. And so I used to work in the military in the administration, and also I was to work as a storeman. So every day those soldiers, they used to come to the office, and they were asking me about, so we need to just type a paper for us because I'm sick, I want to go to the medical center. So I used to go to the shelves to bring the paper. Then the other guy is coming, so now I need allowance for my child, then I have to go to different shelves. So this is, I was making their work, providing what they need, and same time I was making my artwork. So at the same time, I don't have any specific place to create my artwork, so I was doing my artwork. But when I made this box, wooden box, I measured myself. I threw my head, so it has a six gaps, and the height of the book, which is my height. But when they photographed me, and there's documentary photographs, which is inside of the books. So I'm moving and looking to different to four directions in each place. So in order to move the body also for the audience when they are involving looking to this work. So I mean, some of this work I made in the military. Yeah.
Who documented this?
It's documented Hassan. Hassan Sharif, most of my work, by the way, he documented.
We have a question from...
Hi, I'm here to deliver a question from our online audience. This is from McKay. Reem mentioned tradition as a tool that can help you move forward or hold you back. What does tradition do for you?
What does tradition do to ايش التقليد بي كيف بيأثر عليك التقليد؟ ايش علاقتك بالتقليد او التقاليد يعني؟ التقاليد عامة.
I think it's tradition or traditional you mean?
Tradition.
Tradition?
تقاليد.
We have a deep relation with our tradition still. But we are also emphasizing on making contemporary work.
وتقاليد عامة يعني بالمجتمع كيف بالنسبة لك هل هي يعني السؤال هو إنه التقاليد ممكن تكون عائق أو ممكن تكون إشي بيخليك تتقدم لقدام أنت وين موقعك بالنسبة للتقاليد؟
I don't think that those people, traditional people in the society, they will affecting us. I mean. We are collaborating with all these institutions in the UAE, and the heritage it is there, the traditional is still existing in the society, and we do respect that. But beside of that, we have a freedom to make any kind of the work in the UAE. And you can see from not my work, even the work of the Hassan, which goes back to 1979.
This is a question for... Mrs. Fadda, you opened the talk, you framed the talk with this idea of a boom of material production that came after the end of colonial British mandate in 1972, which culminates in the projects of Saadiyat Island, and...
Doesn't culminate.
Begins. Could you speak a little bit to the conflicts that has generated with something you mentioned briefly in the realm of labor and labor rights, especially exemplified with the boycott of the Gulf Labor Group?
What do you mean? You want me to comment on it, or what?
Yes.
In what way? Can you just rephrase your question so that I know exactly how to approach it?
Well, in the sense that you spoke of this the boom after the end of British colonial rule, and now there's a lot of conflict of interest between what some artists that have been invited to participate in this project perceive as new colonial problems generated by the labor that's being used to build the infrastructure of this project.
I mean, I think if I want to emphasize anything, I would say that my intention of discussing that was really to emphasize that there was an active criticism within the UAE art scene itself about this material growth. And regardless of, let's say, the way other artists from the outside world view what is happening within the UAE itself has these questions. And the art scene and their intellectuals have those questions and have been commenting about it and documenting and looking at it in various forms in their own way. And I think that is something that we also have to ask ourselves, like that ethical kind of positionality about what is the society itself looking and introspecting and commenting and criticizing on its own. So that's the way I wanted to position it, really. And I think it's very important to say that Mohammed did that from 2002. And Hassan did that from even earlier on, from the 80s and 90s. So it's criticism is not imposed. And it's something that is also from within the society for the natural growth of that society. I mean, let's look at labor here in New York. I mean, we want to talk about conditions of labor. We have to talk about it elsewhere. But it's really about the society looking at itself and asking itself these questions. And I wanted to emphasize the modernity through that criticism that is manifest in the works of the artists. I hope I answered your question.
Thanks for this talk. It's really eye-opening. I grew up in Bahrain in the 90s, and you know, it's funny that I have to come all the way to New York to hear a conversation about art in my part of the world.
We did it first.
Well, no. I appreciate that, but the point I'm trying to make is that, granted, I left the region when I was very young. Mm-hmm. This kind of discussion, this kind of work, is largely inaccessible to the majority of the population. So my question to you is, who's your audience? What is your obligation to the larger society to really present this work and make an impact?
In the fact, when I mentioned the gap in the society, it was not only gap between the society and the artwork. It was also gap between artists and artists themselves. So that was happening. I mean, there were the majority of the artists, when we were showcasing this work, it was not accepted. They used to criticize in all the media, but we were very confident. And I remember that. So Hassan, he told me once, I received the criticism in the Sharjah Biennale 2005 when I showed my experimental work. Even through those conventional artists from Arab world, or even from the UAE, he said, I will accept your work if it is something written your name, John, on the caption. That's happened in 1995. Then they used to publish again in the newspaper and criticizing our work. And you can't criticize the contemporary artwork through the traditional art vision or scene. But anyway, we were very confident. And he told me also, don't upset. You have to be confident about your artwork. You have to fight for that. Nobody will give you the freedom. You have to take it.
And I think that's very important, because there is an evolution, I believe, in the even the visual semantics of the country, and I think our thinking that this way of making art is not necessarily legible in the atmosphere is, I think that's a misperception. I think there is a level that this work becomes accessible, and there becomes an understanding of this work. I think tools of education and presentation are necessary in order to do that. Hopefully, with the Guggenheim Abu Dhabi, you will see the proper reinstating of those artists and that history and the telling of it and the educating of it through programs, through exhibitions, through the materials, through publications. I mean, we have to look at the fact that this infrastructure has not yet fully been consolidated and therefore supports that art sphere. It's been up to the artist to do it and to curate the shows and to explain it and to explain the works. I mean, audiences need that infrastructure to really start to break down this information for them. And these are part of the tools. Any further questions? Well, I'd like to thank you all for coming. It's been a lovely evening having all of you here, and we welcome you to the reception in the Rotunda. Mm-hmm.